Welcome back. In this section, we'll be looking at Riemann sums, which are a generalization of the process that we looked back at in section 4.2. So as I go through the little discussion here, I'm going to point out some ways in which what we're talking about is more general than what we did in 4.2. So starting as before, we have our interval from A to B. And what we're going to do is partition that interval. So that's what this delta represents here, is the splitting up of my interval into subintervals. So x0, that's my left endpoint for the interval, and xn, that's my furthest to the right endpoint, so a and b. And then everybody else, x1, x2, x3, and so on all the way up to xn, I've got them in increasing order. And for this one, we're not going to make any assumption that these are equally spaced. So it might be something like we're looking at the interval from 0 to 1, and maybe I have 1 and then another little chunk over here. So I've got a narrow little subinterval, a wider one, and then a narrower one. That's totally allowed for this. So here I can have any sort of width of my subintervals that I'd like. They're not all going to be the same delta x. So here I have to be a little bit more precise and say delta xi, so the width of that particular interval. They may or may not be all the same. So when we did it with all of our subintervals being the same width. But here we're free, they can be any size we'd like them to be. Similarly, we're taking whatever point we feel like taking in the interval. That was the same as before. We're usually taking left endpoints and right endpoints for convenience, but any point in that interval works to be our CI. That means that what we're building here is a more general version of our little area formula that we had before. This is still representing, or can be thought of as representing, areas, at least if your function f of x is above the x-axis. That's the other thing that you'll notice is different here. We didn't make any assumptions saying that our function is above the x-axis, which means that these might not really be areas, because if f is negative, then you'd wind up with a negative value. And of course, areas are not negative. But if our function was above the x-axis, then yeah, these would be little rectangles with a width of delta xi and a height of f of ci. So if you're thinking about this, this is sort of like what we were doing before. We were using our y values at particular points in each interval, multiplying by the width of each subinterval, and then we were adding everything up. So what we did before was an example of a Riemann sum in 4.2, but Riemann sums are even more general than that. They don't have to have the same widths, and you can go wild with whatever your choice is for what CI is, and your function doesn't necessarily need to be above the x-axis. So the thing that we'll introduce here is next this idea of the norm of our partition. You'll notice I've got two lines here. This is not an absolute value symbol. When I write the little two vertical lines, the norm of my partition, that's defined as being the largest of our subintervals. So again, if you were thinking about your interval going from 0 to 1, and let's say I had from 0 to 1/4, and then from 1/4 to 3/4, and then from 3/4 to 1, one part would have a width of 1/4, one part has a width of 1/2, and the other part has a width of 1/4. For what my norm is, it would be the largest subinterval, and so in this case, the norm would be 1/2, because that's the widest of my little three subintervals I made. So in this case, the delta, their partition, has its norm, its widest subinterval or largest subinterval. If you had what we had back at 4.2 and you were looking at a regular partition, if everybody had the same width, then the norm would be just delta x, b minus a over n. But even if it wasn't a regular partition, you can still say delta x shouldn't be any larger than b minus a, should be larger than or equal to b minus a over n. And that's just because we're saying that since this is the largest width, b minus a over n would be the average width. The average of all of our subinterval lengths. And of course, whatever the norm is, since it's the largest subinterval, it's going to be larger than average, or at least it'll be equal to average. If it's the largest subinterval, it certainly couldn't be smaller than average. So the norm would never be less than b minus a over n. The other thing that we'll think about here is, instead of talking about our little partitions having n going to infinity, we're going to think about it instead as our norm going to zero. So in other words, we are building many, many more rectangles, but we're letting the widths of our rectangles get narrower and narrower because the biggest one is getting close to zero, so all the smaller ones are also getting close to zero as well. Now, a fun fact, of course, is that if you are letting your width of your biggest subinterval go to zero, then as a consequence, n has to go to infinity. And you can sort of see that from this inequality that we had above. If this value were getting closer and closer to zero, then b minus a over n would have to be less than or equal to zero. But b minus a over n is not negative. So if you're less than or equal to zero and you are not negative, then you'd have to be zero. And of course, the only way that b minus a over n would turn out to be zero, since b and a, those are fixed endpoints, would be if n got infinitely large. So if we have our partition getting smaller and having a norm getting smaller and smaller and smaller, then as a consequence, n, our number of rectangles, is getting larger and larger and larger. So now we introduce the idea of the definite integral. So again, you'll notice that we have some things that we omitted from before. When we were finding area, we were thinking about our function being continuous. We were thinking about our function being above the x-axis. We didn't say anything about that here in our little definition. Just f is some function, and it's defined on that closed interval. And the limit for our Riemann sums over our partitions exists. So when we look at the limit as our norm gets close to zero for our Riemann sum, that exists. If that does, then we say that our function is integrable, that we can find the integral of it. And then we write that limit of the Riemann sums as this, which looks kind of like the indefinite integral from 4.1, suspiciously, except now we have our limits of integration, the a and the b, the beginning and end point of our interval, there on the integral sign. This we call this the definite integral of f. We call a the lower limit and b the upper limit of integration. So one thing that we have to mention here is how do we know if this limit exists? We said that if f is defined and the limit of the Riemann sums over the partitions exist, then the function is integrable. So how do we know if something's integrable? As it turns out, we just need continuity for that, which is kind of nice. So if you have a function and if it's continuous on a closed integral, a closed interval rather, then f is integrable on that closed interval. Okay, so I have this definite integral from negative 1 to 2 of 2x minus 1, and I'd like to evaluate it. And the question is, how do I do that? Because so far we haven't talked about how to evaluate a definite integral. We've talked about indefinite integrals, but for definite ones, we haven't really mentioned anything just yet. So if we're thinking back to the previous slide of what I said a definite integral was, it was the limit of the Riemann sums as the norm goes to zero. And that for that, we needed, as we know from the theorem, we needed a continuous function. If that were continuous, then our function would be integrable. And so we could say that the definite integral was the limit of the sums, the Riemann sums, as the norm goes to zero. So number one, our function here, this 2x minus 1, is continuous. And because it's continuous, that means that it is integrable. So that means that the definite integral of 2x minus 1 from negative 1 to 2 is going to be the limit as our norm of our partition goes to 0 of the sum of f of ci delta xi. And that would be true for, as I said, any Riemann sum that we choose to use for f over that interval with whatever partition we choose to use, with whatever widths we choose to use, with whatever ci we choose to use. As long as our norm is getting close to 0, that'll be the same thing as our definite integral. Now, of course, you can use whatever you'd like, but I'm going to take the easy way out, and I'm going to use a regular partition. And I'm also going to use right endpoints. I mean, I could go wild and come up with some exotic partition, but I feel like why not just make it easy on myself? So if I'm using regular partition, then delta xi is just going to be delta x. That's our difference between our endpoints. We're going from negative 1 to 2, so 2 minus negative 1 all over n. My delta x is 3 over n. And since I'm taking my right endpoints, then ci is the beginning, which is negative 1, plus I times delta x. So here I is negative 1 because we're integrating going from negative 1 to 2. And that delta x we said before was 3 over n. So if we look at ci, that should be then just negative 1 plus 3i over n. And I'm going to need an extra page, so we'll add a page onto that. Okay, so now let's figure out what f of ci is. Our function was 2x minus 1, so f of ci is 2 times ci minus 1, and ci is negative 1 plus 3i over n. So if we were to clean that up, and we'll do that right now, you'd have a minus 2 and another minus 1. So you'd have minus 3, and you'd have a plus 6i over n. So there we go. That's our f of ci. And now we can get our Riemann sum going and say then that our integral from negative 1 to 2 of 2x minus 1 should be the limit as our partition's norm goes to 0 of the sum from 1 to n of f of ci, which we just found, times delta x, which we've also found as 3 over n. So now I just have to do a little bit of work here. So one little bit, of course, is cleaning things up inside my summation. And so when I do that, I have 18 n squared times I, and then minus 9 over n. So I look at my limit as the partition's norm goes to 0. As I said, when the norm goes to 0, that's n going to infinity. So really, it's n going to infinity of this sum. And for this n going to infinity of that sum, I could say, well, for the sum, I know 18 over n squared times sum of the i's would be 18 over n squared times n times n plus 1 over 2. And 9 over n, its sum, since 9 over n is a constant, its sum would be 9 over n times n. And then just a little bit to do here to clean things up further. So as far as the last term goes, the n and the n cancel each other out. I can also cancel the 2 in the 18, leaving 9 behind. And so I'll have in the numerator n squared plus n times 9 over n squared. And then finally, if I divided everybody top and bottom by n squared, I would have limit n goes to infinity of 9 times 1 plus 1 over n minus 9. And now I can evaluate this and I can say, good for me. I have, as n goes to infinity, 1 over n goes to 0. We're left with 9 times 1 plus 0 minus 9, or 9 minus 9, which is 0. So there we go. We've evaluated our first definite integral. So now a little bit of commentary here before we have a pause. Firstly, we're going to see later on that there is, of course, a link between indefinite integrals and definite integrals. We know how we could find the indefinite integral of 2x minus 1. We covered that back in 4.1. So the question is, how does that relate to finding a definite integral? And we'll see that in the next section. That's number one. Second thing to just keep in mind, and this is good news for the rest of the term, if you see a definite integral, that represents some sort of number. So anytime we have an integral with numbers on it, it is a number. If you have an indefinite integral, that's going to be some kind of a function, or rather a family of functions. A couple of other things to keep in mind. So Riemann sums may represent areas, maybe, maybe not, depends on whether or not our function is a positive function. If your function's above the x-axis, then the terms in your Riemann sums are going to be positive, and they will represent areas of rectangles. But that means your Riemann sum might also not represent areas of rectangles if your function was negative. So that means that your Riemann sum could be positive, could be negative. So as a result, a definite integral could be positive or could be negative. It may or may not represent an area. We'll see some more about that in the future. But you can say, though, if you do have a function that's not below the x-axis and if it's integrable, then the definite integral is the area between that function and the x-axis over that interval, rather.